December 5th, 1945, 2:10 p.m., 14 men took off in 5 TBM Avenger torpedo bombers for a routine 3-hour training mission. But the men and their planes disappeared in the Bermuda Triangle. And one of the planes that went on a search and rescue mission later that night to find those 5 bombers also disappeared in the Bermuda Triangle. And to this day, none of the aircraft have been found. But that famous flight, or infamous flight, is now known as Flight 19. Flight 19 took off from the Naval Air Station Fort Lauderdale, Florida, which is now the location of Fort Lauderdale International Airport, just north of Miami. The pilots were to fly east from the Florida coast, approximately 56 nautical miles, to conduct bombing runs in this area. The pilots were to do a bombing run and do the practicing for that, because like everything, you need to practice that skill to be good at it. But the other thing they were doing is something called dead reckoning. There's 2 ways that pilots can navigate, or that were navigating at that time. One, you use pilotage, and that's to use a chart, also known as a map, and we would use that and look out the window to verify where you are. But when you're flying over water, you don't have anything to look at except water. So you use dead reckoning, where you're using a compass and a clock or a watch and your last known position to figure out where you are. That navigating over the water is a skill that you really need to have, especially at this time period where there was no GPS. After the bomb runs, the planes were supposed to continue another 67 nautical miles east before turning north and flying over Grand Bahama Island, not to be confused with the Bahama Islands down south. Each of the Avengers were crewed by 3 naval aviators or Marines, except for 1 aircraft which only had 2 on board. And to give you an idea, these pilots had roughly 300 hours of total flight time, 60 hours of total flight time in this aircraft. Right now, as it is in the United States, to get your commercial license, typically you have about 250 hours. That gives you the license to basically make money, but to get a job at an airline, an unrestricted airline transport pilot license, you need 1,500 hours. I say that just to give you some perspective on how much experience they had. 300 hours total time and 60 in the plane is not a lot in the grand scheme of things. At this time during World War II, and I know this is post-World War II, but at that time, it wasn't common to have a lot of flight time when you were gonna go into combat. But 250 hours, I can tell you from personal experience, you are not really comfortable with everything that's going on while you're flying. You don't have a lot of experience. However, one pilot had 2,500 flight hours. He was the exception, and that's the flight leader, Lieutenant Charles Taylor. Lieutenant Taylor and the other pilots arrived this area about 2:30, so it's a very short flight to get out there, and they finished conducting their bomb runs about 3 p.m. One of the pilots had radioed back for permission to drop his final bomb around 3 p.m., so they know about 3 p.m. they were heading east to continue their flight mission. And that's where things took an unusual turn. The pilot reached here, the second checkpoint, and turned north, but then the flight leader and the other pilots got disoriented to where they were. During this time period, 1945, obviously there was no GPS. If you're lost in the clouds and your compass is not working and then you lose radio transmissions, it can be very complicated. So while you're flying out there over the ocean, trying to figure out which direction to go, it's gonna get very confusing over the ocean because you have no reference points of where to look at, especially if you have cloud cover, because you can't figure out where the sun is setting. That would be the obvious choice. Okay, the sun is setting over here. Let's fly back west towards the sun and we're gonna make it to land. Luckily, Flight 19 had another crew that was about to do the exact same training run and they were on the ground and they radioed and heard Flight 19 having radio issues, so they connected up on the radio. The flight leader, Lieutenant Taylor, transmitted, "Both my compasses are out and I'm trying to find Fort Lauderdale, Florida. I'm over land, but it's broken. And I am sure I'm in the Keys, but I don't know how far down, and I don't know how to get to Fort Lauderdale." He has something that we call ground contact. Basically, that means as a pilot, you're looking down and you can see the ground. But if you have a bunch of clouds, like on a partly cloudy day, from the sky looking down, you're not gonna be able to put together a map in your head or see enough landmarks to figure out where you're at. So he's looking down on this partly cloudy day as the clouds are continuing to move into the area, and he's unable to find enough reference point to figure out where he's at, but he thinks he's in the Keys. Here's the problem. After arriving at checkpoint 2, they were scheduled to turn north and be here over Grand Bahama Island, but the flight leader is saying he's over the Keys, which means he believes they're actually down here. When the pilots left at 2:10, they were scheduled to do a 3-hour flight, which means they topped up the planes full of gas. Especially that time period, you would add a lot of gas because better to have it and not need it than need it and not have it. The problem is as the clouds start to move in, especially during this time, the radio transmissions start to get harder and harder to hear as you're further and further off the coast of Florida. And the weather started to play a bigger impact on what was going on with this flight mission. At 5:50 p.m. local time, 3 hours and 40 minutes after leaving Fort Lauderdale, Flight 19 was hopelessly lost and disoriented. Radars were able to estimate their position here off the coast of what would later be Cape Canaveral. At 6:20 p.m. local time, Taylor's last message was received. This is a really hard one for me to understand as a pilot, because if I'm flying with someone and both their instruments failed, both compasses failed on that aircraft, I'm going to expect that I would use my compass to help me figure out where I'm going. But this is what he said to the pilots. All the planes close up tight. We'll have to ditch unless we landfall. When the first plane drops below 10 gallons, we'll all go down together. So even as a newer pilot with 300 hours total time right now in the US, you're able to be a commercial pilot. So you should have the basic experience of knowing, hey, we took off and we flew this direction, and then we would go north, and they're following their compasses. Even though they're following the flight leader here, if both his compasses failed, you have 4 other planes. My understanding would be I would check with the other pilots who has their compass working. If nobody's compass is working though, because of where they're flying in the Bermuda Triangle, that is going to be a problem because it's going to get very disoriented. But then why did they choose to continue flying north or away from land? The problem is if the pilots knew that they were in this area here, they would just turn west and keep flying until they hit land. But Lieutenant Taylor is insisting they are out here, and going west from this point would certainly mean they would have to ditch their aircraft in the water. Now, a new young pilot who's following a flight leader who has 2,500 hours of experience is going to be easily convinced of following his leader. That's just the way the military was at this time and still is to a degree, unless someone has some common sense to say, hey, our 4 compasses are saying this direction that we went this way and west will get us to land. Lieutenant, let's go west. But that wasn't the case. They were following their leader, and at 7:27 p.m., an hour after the last transmission was heard from Flight 19, the Navy scrambled a PBM Mariner flying boat that took off from Naval Air Station Banana River, which is now Patrick Air Force Base off the coast of Florida. This is common practice in the military. As you can imagine, if a bunch of planes go missing, they're going to send a search and rescue team. This PBM Mariner crew was actually volunteered to do this. They were actually tasked to do a different type of training mission. But when they heard that these five planes went missing and this crew went missing, they volunteered to fly into what was deteriorating and bad weather. Keep in mind, this is a flying boat plane, meaning this plane can take off and land on the water. So despite whatever situation they encounter out there, they ran out of gas or anything like that, they can land anywhere. That's a great thing about flying on a float plane. At 7:30 p.m., the PBM-5 Mariner checked in with a routine check-in call just 3 minutes after departing the base. But that transmission would be the last transmissions from the crew. There were later reports from shipping vessels in the area of an explosion. And when the ships made it out to the region where they thought the explosion was, there was an oil slick, but there was no plane to be discovered. So why would a plane that could land on water like this end up crashing into the ocean? Or was that explosion that those sailors saw not the Mariner? The wreckage of that Mariner and the 5 missing bombers have never been discovered. But why, if you were flying a plane that is made to land on water, would you not land on the water? Why would you end up crashing? I understood when those people went out into search on part of the search and rescue team, they knew what they were going into. And they wouldn't be flying around looking for something if it was unsafe or the visibility was so bad that they couldn't see. And the only thing that they would be able to crash into is water. So even if the pressure was changing at nighttime, you would still not be doing a search and rescue flying 10 feet over the water. These 5 Avengers and this PBM-5 Mariner were some of the first planes to ever disappear into the Bermuda Triangle. But they were far from the last. If you enjoyed this video, check out one of these 2 over here. I look forward to hearing from you. Until then, keep the blue side up.